So we learn about the properties of colloidal salts. First thing is they are heterogeneous. Now why they are heterogeneous? Because you can see Tyndall effect, which we will discuss in the property. You will see electroosmosis, which I'll discuss. You will see electrophoresis. So as because these things or these processes or these techniques are applied on the colloidal solution, they confirm the heterogeneity of the colloidal particles. The colloidal particles are larger than the molecules from heterogeneous mixture composed of particles of dispersed phase and dispersion medium. There is a dispersed phase and there is a dispersed phase. This is what is a dispersed phase and this is the dispersion medium. So in the dispersion medium and the dispersed phase, the colloidal particles are there, and their particles are bigger than the particles of the true solutions, and they are heterogeneous. The heterogeneity can be confirmed by the Tyndall effect, electroosmosis or electrophoresis. This now stability, why is there stability in the colloidal particles? Okay, first thing is due to Brownian motion. So why? You know that Brownian motion is random movement of the colloidal particles, and this can be proved when you see in a cinema hall, whenever there is a projection in the light, you can see the dust particles are moving around. This is what is an example of Brownian motion. This you have learned in class 9. This is very easy. Very easy, and hence that is Brownian motion. You know that. Why Brownian motion exists? Brownian motion exists because the particles of the dispersion medium mein jo particles hai, okay, they strike the particles of the colloidal medium, and hence the particles of the dispersed phase move in random directions. That is Brownian motion. Now why is there stability because of Brownian motion? Because due to Brownian motion, the effect of gravity is nullified and they don't precipitate down easily. So this is the reason of the stability, first reason of the stability. Second reason is that the colloidal particles are charged. And as because the colloidal particles are charged, that's why they are stable, because they repel from one another. All the colloidal particles are similarly charged, either positively charged or negatively charged. And if the colloidal particles are positively charged, then the dispersion medium particles will be negatively charged. If the colloidal particles are negatively charged, then the dispersion medium will be positively charged. That you should keep in mind. And because of that, there is stability in the colloidal particles or on the colloidal solution. Now the question that arises, that from where colloids get charged, colloids or dispersion medium or dispersion phase and medium gets charged. This is the question that arises, definitely should arise in your mind. See, remember one thing, that suppose arsenous sulfide is there, AH2S3, okay. Arsenous sulfide particles, when in a dispersion medium, in water, suppose, okay, water is the dispersion medium, the arsenous sulfide particles are negatively charged and the water hence becomes positively charged. Wow, this is first thing. In ferric hydroxide solution, suppose you have taken ferric hydroxide, FeOH3, the FeOH3 particles are negatively charged and the water becomes positively charged. Now this is quite a question. How does this happen? Okay, this happens due to various factors, and because of this charge they get stable. That you understand. First reason of being electrically charged is frictional electrification. Now in frictional electrification, what happens? By mutual rubbing of the colloidal particles with the dispersion medium, they get charged. So obviously you can understand, if they get charged due to frictional rubbing, if this gets positively charged, they will get negatively charged. That is one thing. By electron capture, number second is by electron capture. You have learned the Bredig's method. You remember you had put two electrode, and there was gold inside, and the gold evaporated out, and then again settled because there was ice put, okay, and again settled in condensation. So when they move out and settle down by condensing because of the ice, then they from the air or from this medium they had captured some electrons and had become charged. So this may be a method. Number third reason of getting charged is preferential absorption. Preferential absorption of ions from solution. So what happens in this preferential absorption of ions from solutions? You see, suppose an ionic colloid is there. Suppose, for example, AgCl. Now, AgCl lattice, according to the lattice structure, okay, you know about the lattice structure, yes or no? According to the lattice structure, from the, solution, they either absorb Ag plus or Cl minus. Okay, now according to the lattice structure of AgCl, they can, absorb Cl minus and put it into their lattice, and hence the colloidal particles will get negatively charged and the solution will become positively charged due to dispersion of the Ag plus all around. Okay, so this may be a method. Okay, then what may be the other methods of getting charged? There are lots of methods. Number fourth method of getting charged is dissociation of molecules followed by agitation. Dissociation after agitation. This is classic example is micelle. In micelle, the Na plus from the RCOO minus gets separated and it goes into the entire medium. The Na plus moves around in the entire medium and the RCOO minus forms the micelle like this. Now these micelle particles, if you imagine, forms the colloidal dispersed phase and the entire dispersion medium becomes positively charged. So this is how are some of the methods the colloidal solutions may get charged. Okay, number fifth, how it may get charged. Earlier also, suppose for example in AH2S3 you have put H2S. Okay, in AH2S3 medium, AH2S3, okay, you have put H2S. Now what will happen, this H2S will break down as H plus and S minus 2. Okay, so now this S minus 2 will absorbed by the AH2S3. So the colloidal particles will become negatively charged and the water medium will become positively charged in that case. FeOH3, as I have said, in FeOH3 what happens, the OH minus gets dissolved in the water and Fe itself dissociated and Fe plus 3 so remains. So the Fe plus 3 ions forms the colloidal particles and OH minus goes away. Okay, so the colloidal dispersed phase becomes positively charged and the dispersion medium becomes the negatively charged. So these are some of the methods how they become charged. Okay, so I hope that you have understood about some properties of the colloids that I have begun, that they are heterogeneous. Why they are heterogeneous? Because you can see electroosmosis, electrophoresis, and Tyndall effect. About Tyndall effect, I'll talk. Oh, I have talked about, I have not talked about Tyndall effect. Then I have talked about stability. Instability, I have talked about stability is because of the Brownian motion, and that's why gravity cannot pull it. And colloidal particles are charged, and that's why they feel repulsion between each other and are hence dispersed, in the dispersed phase. And how they become charged, these all just I have discussed. I'll send you the pictures. So this is the thing. Now, as because colloids are charged, as because the colloids are charged, as because the colloids are charged, what actually happens is, you see, you can do electroosmosis and you can also do electrophoresis. Electrophoresis is nothing. I'll show a diagram from my book so that you can understand. Electrophoresis was previously known as cataphoresis also. Okay. So I will tell you from my diagram from my book. Look at this diagram. In this, the colloidal salt is dispersed. Now a positively charged, negatively charged cathode and a positively charged anode is being put. You see, all the colloidal solution has disintegrated here when you had gone there. Why? Because has deposited here. Because why? Because the colloidal particles must be what? Negatively charged, and the colloidal solution must be, the dispersed phase must be negatively charged and the dispersion phase must be positively charged. So all the particles of the dispersed phase of the colloidal particles of the salt moved into the negatively charged particles moved into the anode. So this is known as electrophoresis. Movement in the presence of electric field, movement, the movement of colloidal particles under the influence of the electric field is called electrophoresis. Previously it is known as cataphoresis because most of the colloids had a positively charged dispersed phase, and that's why they negatively charged dispersed phase, that's why always they moved towards the anode. So that's why they called it cataphoresis also, but that is different thing. Now we call it electrophoresis. And what is electroosmosis? Look, in electroosmosis the colloidal solution is given, it is separated by semipermeable membrane, where the colloidal salt particles or the dispersed phase will not be allowed to move out. Only the dispersion medium will be allowed to move out under the influence of the electric field. This is known as electroosmosis. So I hope you have understood up to this much. Now in the next video we will go into more properties.